Yeah, thanks. The team feels so much better now that it's cleared up.
You are Locked On Fantasy Basketball, your daily podcast on fantasy basketball. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team, every day.
Hello and welcome to the Locked On Fantasy Basketball podcast brought to you by Fantrax and Basketball Monster. And today's Locked On Fantasy Basketball podcast is also brought to you by Lord Timepieces. Use the promo code LOFANTASY for 10% off and get free shipping on your purchase as well. The show today is also brought to you by Joshua K, who is today's Patreon sponsor. So head across to patreon.com/redrock_bball. My name is Josh Lloyd, and you can find me on Twitter at @redrock_bball as well. We've got Sunday's games to break down. There were four games in the NBA, very light slate due to a conference championship week in the NFL. And then we head across to Monday, where there are nine games on. So
let's get to it.
All right, we're going to start off the show by looking at the week ahead. Looking at looking at week 14 in the NBA to try and work out how we can set our lineups, weekly leagues, daily changes leagues, streaming options, all that sort of stuff. So let's look at the week ahead now. It is week 14, as I mentioned. The game split we've got this week, a fairly standard sort of a week, I guess. 9 games on Monday, we have 6 on Tuesday, 10 on Wednesday, 4 on Thursday, 10 on Friday, 7 on Saturday, and 8 games on Sunday. So the days we're really good, look, you could potentially stream someone in every day, but I normally look for 8 or less as the key ones to look at. So Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, Sunday are the 4 days of the week that I've got 8 games or less on, and you would be able to stream a player in on those days to help fill out your lineup. So they're the days you should be targeting. Let's talk about weekly leagues, though. We'll start with those and which teams play the most games for the week. There are 20 teams this week playing 4 games. So in a lot of cases, you're going to be choosing between 4 game players to start or to bench. We've got 2 teams that play 2 games and we've got 8 teams that play 3 games. So obviously those teams that are playing 2 games, going to be real hard to use either of those because they're the Pistons and the Lakers, and they just don't have a player who's good enough to be considered a must-start player in the majority of formats. I can't really see anyone in any 12-team league. Maybe Andre Drummond in a punt free throw head-to-head scenario, but even then, I don't think that that's going to be a great option with so many teams playing 4 games this week. I'm not sure Drummond fits into must-start territory. For the 4-game teams, as always, there are differences in 4-game schedules. Cleveland and Washington have the best schedules for the week. They take on the Pelicans. Cleveland takes on the Pelicans. They take on the Kings. They have the Nets and they have the Thunder. The Wizards have the Hornets, the Celtics, the Hawks, and the Pelicans. So some good matchups for those teams. Yeah, down the bottom of things, the Thunder and the Nets don't have as good a go of things. The Thunder take on the Jazz, the Pelicans, the Mavericks, and the Cavs. While the Nets have the Spurs, they have the Heat, they have the Cavs, they have the Timberwolves. Really horrible, horrible matchup. So when you're looking at players, if you've got a fringe guy who's a 4-game player for the Wizards or a fringe guy that's a 4-game player for the Nets, and they're both sort of equivalent in their usual value, you take the one that's on the Wizards because he's got the easier matchups. He takes on Charlotte instead of the Spurs. It's a big difference in terms of what they'll be able to achieve over the course of the week. Go through those teams that do play the games that, of course, the 4 games for the week: the Hawks, the Nets, the Celtics, Hornets, Bulls, Cavs, Warriors, Rockets, Pacers, Heat, Bucks, Pelicans, Knicks, Thunder, Sixers, Kings, Spurs, Raptors, Wizards, and Jazz. And the 3 game teams, we've got Dallas, Denver, the Clippers, Memphis, Minnesota, the Magic, the Suns, and the Trail Blazers. Some other anomalies of the schedule: we've got the Rockets that play all 4 of their games on the road. That's not something that happens all that often, so that's an anomaly there. The Spurs also have the same thing, all 4 of their games on the road, whereas the Pelicans, they've got all 4 of their games at home. So if you've got players who are really more productive at home or on the road, you can check that out because that could make a difference in those scenarios. If we want to look at daily changes leagues, we're looking at quality games, and we're looking at players that you might add that, you know, they've got 4 games this week, so you've got limited transactions. Is that going to work for you, or will they just sit on the bench for the majority of the week? So the Cavs have got 4 games this week. So Iman Shumpert's been playing very well. but only one of those games comes on a day with less than nine games played. The Cavs play Monday, they play Wednesday, they play Friday. All days with 9, 10, and 10. So you get Ad Shumpert, and he might not actually see action for you. They also play on Sunday. The Rockets, the same thing. The Knicks, the Kings, the Hornets, the Heat, the Bucks, the Hawks, the Pelicans, and the Nets, they've all got four games this week, but only have one game on a day where you could potentially use them. Contrast that to the Jazz, who play four games, and they have three games on those low scheduled days. So a guy like Joe Ingles is going to have, you know, really high value because you can actually get three games extra out of him. You add him at the start of the week, he won't play all four of those for you, but he'll likely play three. So that is a big difference. Then you've got some of the three-game teams, the Timberwolves, the Suns, the Nuggets. They play three games, all three of them on the low scheduled days. So adding a player from Minnesota, adding a player from Phoenix would be more useful perhaps than adding a player from the Knicks, who have got four games but only one game on a light schedule. So that is important as well. It's not always just about volume of games. It's where those games are. How do they fit? Can you actually use them for all four of those games? So that's important to note. If you want to look at streaming strategies, depending on, have a look how your team shapes up for the week. You might have roster spots on every day. I don't know. I'm basing it on eight or less. So I'm looking at Tuesday, I'm looking at Thursday, I'm looking at Saturday, Sunday. So we're looking at pseudo back-to-backs as well. Who's got the pseudo back-to-back Tuesday, Thursday? We've got Utah, Minnesota, Phoenix, and Denver. And those four teams all have the pseudo back-to-back Thursday, Saturday. So a well-timed ad on, say, Monday for a player from the Jazz, the Suns, the Wolves, or the Nuggets can get you three games for one ad. They play Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. You probably won't have room for anyone on Wednesday. You probably won't have room for anyone on Friday. So those four teams are the ones to hit up. I already said they've got the three quality games, but they come on the first three quality days of the week. So adding them is going to be a great use of those additions. For the Saturday, Sunday back-to-back, there's only one team that's got that back-to-back, and that is the Warriors. And they have very little that's around on waiver-wise, with the exception of Zaza Pachulia. He'd be a guy that you'd look at over the weekend. On that Friday, there were 10 games on. You can't make an ad that's necessarily going to make a difference on Friday, but you add Zaza and get two games for the price of one across the weekend, and then you can use your other streaming spot or your other additions to make whatever necessary moves there are for Sunday in order to target the categories you need to win. But the Warriors don't have many awesome streamable guys, but Zaza is going to be the player to target across that weekend. You could potentially take a guy like Andre Iguodala or even an Ian Clark perhaps, but Zaza is clearly the number one option out of that group of players. So that sets us up for the week ahead. Now let's talk about today's sponsor, which is Lord Timepieces. You know what Lord Timepieces are? You should. It's a London fashion brand. They provide watches, and really, really nice watches as well. The prices are fantastic. We're talking about watches that start at only $70. And these aren't tacky watches. These aren't poor quality watches. These are affordable watches at reasonable prices that are stylish, that are well-constructed, and they look fantastic. I was so happy when I got mine. It looks really awesome. I got a black leather band, a black face, red minutes and seconds hands moving across. Very, very stylish stuff. Free shipping worldwide. You can't really complain about, well, you can't complain about that whatsoever. Classic designs, quality construction, styled minimalism is the name of the game over at Lord Timepieces. They are based in London, and they've sold over 100,000 watches worldwide through their website. They are able to make these prices cheaper because they don't go into department stores. They're selling it all through their website. So they're passing that saving on to you. Everyone who wants a quality looking watch without having to spend $400 or $500, you head across to Lord Timepieces and they can give you that sort of watch at a fraction of the cost. Fabulous to look at, fabulous to wear. They perform well. Everything about Lord Timepieces is fantastic. And I'm assured that you will find something that you like on there, whether it's for yourself or buying it for a loved one. You can do that on Lord Timepieces and find something and save yourself a fair bit of cash in the process. Also, not only are their prices cheap, but if you use my promo code, which is LOFANTASY, you can get 10% off. And this is including free shipping. So you get 10% off the price. You don't pay any shipping costs whenever you go to buy a watch. So head to LordTimepieces.com, use that promo code LOFANTASY, get your watch, get your 10% off, get your free shipping, and get yourself a stylish watch and pocket that extra cash that's coming your way, because Lord Timepieces is going to provide you something at great quality for a very low price. Check out LordTimepieces.com. Let's head in to the monstrous line of the night now. Eric Bledsoe gets it. He has been fantastic lately. He had a career high 40 points in the upset victory over the Raptors. 6 boards, 13 assists, 4 threes, 11 and 17 from the field, and 14 of 14 from the free throw line. A couple of things are happening with Bledsoe. He was quiet to start the year when the Suns were feeding TJ Warren. We know there's been issues with TJ Warren this year, but it seems to be that with Bledsoe taking over, it is impacting what Warren is able to do this year. So I have had some decent hopes for Warren, but this correlation of Bledsoe quiet, Warren going off, Bledsoe going off when Warren went out, and Bledsoe continue to go off with Warren seeing less of the ball and less touches, it seems like those two are fairly negatively correlated. And Bledsoe is obviously by far the best player. He is still the best player on this team. He is a top 12 player over the last 2 weeks. He's a top 20 player over the last month. He's just outside the top 20 for the season. And for the year, he is averaging 21, 5, and 6. 1.5 steals, 1.5 threes, shooting 45 and 85. You took that punt on him in the drafts, which there was a lot of risk associated with him. I didn't believe that the risk was really quite as high as it was put out amongst other people, or as what the prevailing thought was. I'm not taking him, he's injury prone. And yes, he has missed some time throughout his career, but I've gone over this a million times. I think that he is fine to go, and obviously he is crushing it at the moment and putting up big performances, and he's been really, really impressive this season. So you love what he's doing. His last 4 games, he is averaging 29, 6.5, and 9.5, 2.3 triples, and 1.3 steals. That puts him as the 5th best player over the last week. 49 and 97, his shooting, and he's only turning it over 2.5 times for those of you who care about turnovers. He is putting up massive, massive numbers, and you might consider that a sell high, but I don't think Bledsoe's a guy that you're going to necessarily be able to sell high on, because again, it takes players 5 years to shake injury-prone labels. Brook Lopez is still injury-prone, yet he hasn't been injured for 3 years. This is what happens, and he gets that moniker, he gets that reputation. So you're not going to be able to say, look at this, Bledsoe's he's a first-round player over the last 2 weeks. He's a guy that's 15th over the last month. You're not going to get that value back. Yes, he might drop off and move back from 15 to 25. But in the end, I don't think you're going to get much better than that back in a trade. So I would listen to offers. I would offer him around. But it's not like a player who gets overvalued. He's not a player. He consistently gets undervalued. And that makes it a real tough situation in terms of trying to sell high. So in general, I'd just be saying, just deal with it. Just have it. Love the production. Expect a marginal slip, but I wouldn't be expecting too much of a slip-off. He has been fantastic, and he is really doing some good stuff for the Phoenix Suns. I'm sure Suns fans would be happy. I'm sure Suns fans would be interested to see what they could acquire for him in a trade on the real-life NBA trade market. But he's putting up some big, big numbers. The waiver wire line of the night goes to another point guard, and it is Chris Dunn in Minnesota, who started this game with Ricky Rubio out for personal reasons. Rubio was out because of a death in his family. I believe his grandmother passed away, so Rubio was not playing. It was not an injury. It was not a trade. He's grieving, so that's why he was out. Chris Dunn had 10 points. He had 6 points in about the first 2 minutes as he hit 2 open threes. Ended up with 10 points on 3 of 8 shooting. Had 8 boards, 9 assists, 3 steals, and a block. Only 2 of 4 from the free throw line. So really some nice numbers from Chris Dunn here. But there's nothing that we do about this. We don't go and rush to grab him in 12-team leagues. Ricky Rubio is back for the next game. He'll be with the team. And yeah, there's talk of trades of Rubio and all that sort of stuff. But I think making big changes to rosters or holding guys who play limited minutes majority of the time waiting for a trade is in general a losing proposition. And I don't really think that you grabbing Dunn now is going to result in you having a top 50 guy post trade deadline. I just don't think that'd be the case. I think you might grab him and he might be the 100th guy post trade deadline if Rubio moves and another point guard doesn't come back. I don't think his ceiling is all that high to justify holding on to a guy that in the games prior to, say, he played 34 minutes today and he played 25 in the other one when Rubio hurt his hip. The two previous games to that, Chris Dunn had 0 points in 9 minutes and 0 points in 13 minutes. He had 4 points in 12 minutes and 6 points in 13 minutes. So his previous four games, he had 10 points total. He had two assists total, and he had three steals total in those games. So are you willing to hold on to that for a month on the hope that Rubio gets traded? And as was always with these trade scenarios, you're waiting for multiple things to happen. You want Rubio to get traded, yes. And then you don't want another point guard to come back who would start over Dunn. So that you're waiting on two things to happen. So there's a 50-50 chance of Rubio getting traded, and then there's a 50-50 chance of no point guard coming back who will start over Dunn. So it's a 25% chance of it actually working out in Chris Dunn's favor. So it's not like it's, oh, this is 90% going to happen. It's 70% going to happen. If you have different valuations of those odds, if you think that there's 80% chance that Rubio goes and a 10% chance that a point guard comes back, then maybe it makes more sense to you. I don't believe that those are the odds, and I don't believe that, you know, holding him 3 weeks, 4 weeks out from a trade deadline is necessarily the best move. But still an impressive line from Dunn. It gets it done with those, pun unintended, with those three steals. Hit a couple of threes, which is always a surprise for him. But he does worry me. Again, he is a really poor free throw shooter as well. 60% from the line this year, and was 2 of 4 from the stripe in this game. Let's head across to the young gun of the night, and it is Dunny's teammate. It's Karl Towns. He was fantastic, Townsie. 32 and 12 with 7 assists, 1 steal, 4 blocks, 13 of 19 from the field, and 6 of 8 from the free throw line. Over the last 2 weeks, Karl Anthony Towns is the number one player. Number one in the last 2 weeks. So we talk about him being a disappointment. He is absolutely flying. He's number 8 over the last month, and it all is coming down to him improving his shooting, which was the big issue with him all season, where he's still 4% under his numbers from last year, but over the last month, he's shooting 54 and 88. Consequently, he's ranked 8th in fantasy leagues. And that's about the spot that you should have drafted him. And if he can continue this shooting form, which in the last 2 weeks he's shooting 64% from the field, which is obviously very high. But if he can continue mid-50s, then he's going to be a top 10 guy for the rest of the way. And that's the bottom line. That's just what he's going to be. His last three games, 27 and 16, 37 and 12, 32, 12 and 7, as he had today. In fact, his last two games, he's combined for 69 points,
giggity,
24 rebounds, 12 assists in those two games, and shooting, 30 from 43 from the field, putting up massive, massive numbers. And we do tend to forget about Towns because Embiid and Jokic are the two sexy young big men on the block this season, but These are the numbers that we expected from Towns in the offseason. These are the numbers that when we talked about Towns last season, that he is going to be a number one fantasy player within the next 3-4 years. These are the numbers that we're expecting, and they're coming in this stretch. It's a small stretch, but it's coming. And you should be pretty happy if you took him. You wouldn't be happy if you took him at 3, but grabbing him mid to late first round, he's starting to repay it back now. And I think it's going to be pretty much all systems go from here on out for Karl Anthony Towns. Let's move on to the dud of the night. This bloke's got a fair few of these this year. Kenneth Faried with 0 points, 2 rebounds, 0 assists, 0 steals, 0 blocks. Did not attempt a single field goal or a single free throw. He is still, over the last 2 weeks, the 99th ranked player. But with Darrell Arthur back, with Wilson Chandler back, I really don't see a point in owning Ken Faried. His last three games, 25, 24, 14 minutes, and occasionally he has these big performances, but he has started these last three games and done nothing with them. I can understand holding Faried in 12 team leagues. I would never have held him. That's not hold it. What's wrong with my words? I never would have held him from the start of the season, but he was worth a pickup when those guys were out. But now I would be considering moving on. And a lot of the time with Faried, a big line comes on an unsustainable field goal percentage. So you look back to his game 4 games ago or 5 games ago where he had back-to-back 20-point games. They came on 19 of 21 shooting across the 2 games, which was never going to continue. And then he shot 29%, 71%, and then didn't shoot at all today. So Faried is not a 10-team league guy at all. He's a borderline 12-team league guy, but I think he's a borderline guy with the arrow pointing down. I'd rather grab a borderline guy with the arrow pointing up at this point in the season, just trying to get something. I just don't see with Arthur back, with Chandler back, I don't see Fareed being able to increase his role or increase his production too much from here on out. All right, let's move into these four games now and talk about them in a bit more detail. The first game we'll take a look at, where are we? All right, the Golden State Warriors and the Orlando Magic. Pretty comfortable victory for the Warriors, as we expected. Steph Curry was fairly warm. 27-4-6 with 7 triples for Steph. He hit them on 8 of 15 shots from the field, so 53% conversion, while Klay Thompson also dropped in 7 triples. He did it on 9 three-point attempts, 7 of 9 from 3 for those two guys. Klay scored only 21 points, so they all came on threes. Only had 5 boards and not much else, while Kev Durant had a very full line. Didn't love the efficiency from Durant going 5 of 12, but 15-10-6 with 3 steals and 2 blocks is a very nice performance. There was no Sean Livingston. He was out resting in this game. So we saw extra minutes from Pat McCaw and Ian Clark. McCaw scored 10 points. He took 11 shots. He hit 4 of them, but we haven't really seen him in a role as large as this for a while. It's nice to see. But he's a guy that we're talking about maybe 2 years away from becoming even a top 150 guy. I do think that he can get there. I do like McCaw, but yeah, not happening for a while. Draymond had 6-10-4, no defensive numbers, and shot 1 of 7 from the field. So a little bit of a disappointing night from him. And I did touch on Zaza Pachulia earlier. 20 minutes for Zaza, 14-5 with 2 steals on 7 of 8 shooting. I think at this point, Zaza's a must-own 14-team league guy. He's owned in only 15% of Yahoo leagues. That needs to be higher. And you could make an argument, I think he's the 120th ranked player over the last month. You could make an argument that fits on 12 team leagues. There's nothing spectacular about Zaza, but he does it with a decent percentage. He gets some steals, he can pass, he's scoring a bit, he's getting rebounds. And instead of playing 18 minutes a night, he's playing like 21, 22. And that's making the difference between him being a 16 team league guy and a borderline 12 team must own 14 team league guy. And on those nights where you've got those low schedule nights or the back-to-backs like the weekend, yeah, Zaza becomes a quality guy to add, especially with David West out and no one being able to trust JaVale McGee, James Michael McAdoo, Damian Jones, Kevon Looney, Anderson Varejao. Man, the Warriors have got so many bad big men. Yeah, Zaza could have a role like this moving forward, and it is something that probably is flying under the radar of a lot of people, but you need to pay attention. For the Magic, they went with CJ Watson again, so that tricky Frank Vogel not telling you what the starting lineup is. Why don't you just say it's the same? Didn't matter. You got your ass kicked by 20 points, so good on you. CJ Watson continued starting. We had the same starting lineup as we did the other day, as I mentioned, and Watson played 36 minutes. He had 12-2-4 with 2 steals in those 36 minutes. This is because Evan Fournier is out, and I think that Fournier is going to miss some more time. Jody Meeks is out, and then DJ Augustine sprained his ankle after his first 5 minutes on the court. So we're going to have to see some decent minutes from both Watson and Mario Hezonja now, and it's also going to allow Lord Alfred Payton to play a shit ton of minutes. 39 minutes for Alfred here, 23-4-10 with a steal and a 3. He is a top 50 player over the last month, Payton. He was 61% from the field. This is exactly what he was able to do in college. Can't shoot, but still gets a high field goal percentage for his ability to finish. He's a really good finisher at the rim, and he has improved that area. He has been a big surprise, I think, this season, especially considering he was benched for DJ Augustine, which was always stupid at the time. And yeah, playing him less minutes than Augustine really at any time is a dumb decision. But Payton has been a much improved player, and it goes without saying that he is a must-own guy. Vucevic, it's always going to be a problem for Vuce playing against the Warriors. 24 minutes, 12-4 with 2 steals and a block, while Serge Ibaka only saw 21 minutes. He had 10-3. That enabled Bismack Biyombo to get some extra playing time. He double-doubled with 12-14 and 3 blocks, and that's 2 strong games from Bismack in a row. I'm not necessarily sure that it continues, and even if he's playing 30 minutes or not, he's not a must-own 12-team league guy anyway, so it should only be guys in 14 or 16-team leagues that are paying much attention to Bismack Biyombo at this point. Aaron Gordon, 8 points in 34 minutes on 14 shots. He went 4 of 14 from the field. Not a great night, but 5 assists, a steal, a block, that's fine. Totally passable. You want the shots to fall, obviously, but 34 minutes, good numbers. I'm okay with that. It's been a rough ride with Gordon this season, but still, you've got to be owned in all leagues. Also, if you're unaware, Anthony Brown is on the Magic now after he was cut by the Lakers in preseason, signed by the Pelicans, and then cut there. Now he has landed himself in Orlando. He played 4 minutes in the ultimate garbage time situation. Let's move on to the next game now. The Los Angeles Lakers and the Dallas Mavericks. Probably give this game 30 seconds because the Lakers got beaten by 50. What is there to say? There's nothing to say in this game. They were pounded. They were humiliated. No numbers worth viewing at all. This game was over early second quarter, so minutes were spread all over the place. The best thing I can say from a Lakers point of view is Larry Nance returned. He played 10 minutes and had 4 points. And you know, 14 to 16 team lead guys will want to go and grab Nance in that scenario. But otherwise, not a lot. Also, there's no reason to be holding Ivica Zubats in any 12-team leagues. I just don't see him becoming a viable player in a time frame that's quick enough. You know I like him. You know I think he's going to be great, but I just don't see Walton and the Lakers going, all right, Ivica, let's play 26 a night moving forward. I just can't see that happening in the near future. Also, Brandon Ingram, horrible here. 2 of 12 for 6 points with an assist. I think he was had a negative 66 net rating in this game, which if you don't know net ratings, that's really poor. For the Mavericks, it's almost the same story. Like, well, what do I say for a team that just blew people out? Now, Wes Matthews, he only played 14 minutes with a sore hip. He is probable for the next game, so that's good news. The best news here, though, for the Mavericks was Justin Anderson, who's been in Rick Carlisle's doghouse all season. He took a huge step forward last year in March, April, and the playoffs, put up some good numbers, and I thought there was a big role for him here. And I do still think that they want him to be their starting three at some point moving forward, put the pencil to the four when Dirk Nowitzki retires. But Carlisle has not been impressed with anything that Anderson has done this year, but this was a good game from him, a huge game. He had 19 points on 11 shots. He hit 3 triples, he had 5 boards, and he had a steal. Hit all 6 of his free throws, getting to the line 6 times, the most out of anybody on the team. Anderson can be a very good fantasy player. He blocks shots, he gets steals, he gets rebounds, he hits threes, and he can score. That's a pretty good skill set for a wing. It's not happening this year. I don't think there's any illusions about that, but we're talking dynasty stuff potentially next year, but maybe the year after for a guy that can have, you know, 3 to 4 years of maybe top 80 production. I think that's what you should be expecting with Anderson at some point, but it has been a very rocky ride so far this season for him. JJ Barea is going to be out until after the All-Star break as well. So Seth Curry is going to be getting these 30 minutes every single night. He had 14 points with 3 assists. He doesn't have very high upside. But in 30 minutes for the next 3-4 weeks, that's a no-brainer guy to add. Phoenix and Toronto. Huge win for the Suns on the road, 115-103. Talked about Bledsoe already. Tyson Chandler got his stock standard 35 minutes. He went 16-9, got to be owned everywhere. And Devin Booker had 20 points with 5 triples, 4 rebounds, and 2 steals. He puts up lines where you go, this is his ninth straight 20-point game in a row. That's great, but it just never screams brilliant fantasy stuff. And you just get the feeling he's never going to be a top 20 fantasy producer, or maybe not even ever a top 30 guy. I just feel like he might be limited to this player who's just maybe Wes Matthews-y like in terms of prime Portland Wes Matthews, where he had, you know, 3-4 seasons where he was a guy that was ranked 40 to 60. Not saying these guys are the same players, just they're, you know, they score, they can hit some threes, and they can be fantasy contributors in that mid-round range. Maybe DeMar DeRozan, like a lesser DeMar DeRozan as well, except for obviously hitting threes with less assist numbers, because DeRozan's an underrated passer. But Booker has been much better than what he was to start the season, and he's obviously coming good at the right time of the year. Alex Len saw 21 minutes in a surprise, played alongside Tyson Chandler, because that's always a great move when you've got two rookie power forwards playing a guy out of position. 4-10 for Len, but he's not in the Earl Watson good graces, or TJ Warren. I talked about him earlier, struggled. 21 minutes, 4 points, 3 rebounds. It's getting to, if you're in a 10-team league, I think that you can move on from Warren, to be honest. In a 12-team league, it depends. It depends on where you are. It depends on who's available. But he's moving, if he's not already there, he's moving towards that drop zone pretty quickly. Because, as I touched on earlier, that Eric Bledsoe is taking control more. At the beginning of the season, it was Warren and Booker that were doing it. Now it's Bledsoe and Booker. And that's the way that it really should be in all common sense. But it looked like the Bledsoe was taking a back seat, whether that was him or whether that was instructed. But that's the way it looked at the start of the year. But it's clearly not that way now. When PJ Tucker goes, then there are going to be more minutes and more touches for him. But for now, it's a real It's a real struggle to hold on. PJ Tucker, 11 and 10 in 32 minutes, while Marquise Chris, he got his early fouls going, 4 points in 17 minutes, and Dragan Bender lasted just 4 minutes with ankle soreness. For the Raptors, Jonas Valanciunas, 31 minutes. I love seeing Jonas play 31 minutes. This was a game without Pat Patterson, but I feel he should always be playing these sort of minutes. 16 and 12 with a steal and three blocks for Valanciunas, while Bebe Noguera started next to him and played 35 minutes. 13 and 5 for Bebe. He hit a three, he had a steal, he had two blocks, and he was fantastic. While Patterson is out, I think you can own Bebe in 12-team leagues. I'm not really sure that he necessarily sticks there, but I think he's around the 100th ranked player for the entirety of the season. But once everyone is back, I just don't see him getting enough run to be a must-own sort of guy. He'll be a specialist, he'll be a streamer, he'll be a 14-team league guy, but that's probably about it. Damari Carroll had a good game after a couple of real stinkers in a row. 14 and 4 with two steals for Damari in his 32 minutes. Well, DeRozan had 22, 3, and 4. Kyle Lowry, you're not so great. 15 points on 17 shots for Lowry. 5 of 17 from the field. 4 rebounds, 6 assists. This is post-All-Star Kyle Lowry. This is the regression that I talk about when I say that if you can trade Kyle Lowry for a top 7 player, you do it immediately in a heartbeat, because you can't do that now, because he has dropped off from that little run that he was having. And I'm a big fan of Kyle. I've been a big fan of Kyle Lowry for years and years, and I was always on him as a guy who was... I targeted him in nearly every draft because I could always get him 20, 30 spots ahead of where he was supposed to go. But now he's the guy that everyone wants to give a reach around to. And you have to capitalize on those moments if they're available, because regression was going to come. It's not necessarily set in for good, but we're seeing him drop back to probably where he should be. And that's that guy that's a second round, mid to late second round type of player. Jared Sullinger, 12 minutes for Sully. He had 9 points, 3 rebounds, 2 steals. Yeah, good numbers. I just don't see him getting enough minutes this season to be a 12-team league player, especially with the play of Bebe and the return of Pat coming. Norm Powell had 4 points in 6 minutes. He was bumped from the starting lineup for Bebe to start again here. Let's move into the last game of the night, and it was a cracker. The Denver Nuggets and the Minnesota Timberwolves. The Timberwolves get the victory 111-108. Let's start with the Nuggets. Nick Jokic had some foul issues, so that limited him to 27 minutes, but 18, 8, and 4, 3 steals and a block. He still just puts them up, and it feels like he's unstoppable. Michael Malone, yeah, how's the best way to phrase this? Stop talking shit. And Gary Harris will be back. He'll be on a minutes restriction. Cool. So he was going to play 48 minutes otherwise? Because he played 35 minutes in his first game back, and that's fine, but this is the second time this has happened with Harris. No, he'll be back. He'll play a minutes restriction. And then he played 33, I believe, in his first game back the last time. It's just frustrating, but obviously it's great news for Gary Harris owners. 22 with 6 and 3, 2 triples and a steal. And he did it on 9 of 13 shooting. And him and Jokic have a ridiculous chemistry, and as do Jokic and Murray. Jokic makes any guard better that knows how to position themselves and score and shoot, which Harris and Murray both do. Harris should be owned in all leagues, I believe. Darrell Arthur had a nice start. 21 minutes, 10, 3, and 4. Not start, return. 10, 3, and 4 with 2 triples, 3 blocks, and a steal. Got it all done there. He's a guy that you look at in 16-teamers, though. While Wilson Chandler scored 17 in 34 minutes. The Rooster returned, went 14, 6, and 4 in 35 minutes. Well, Jamal Murray was very impressive here. Yes, Jameer Nelson started and played 28 minutes. He went 9, 2, and 2. But Murray playing backup point guard for the first time all season, really. 17, 5, and 3 on 7 of 13 shooting. You know that I'm very high on Jamal Murray. I'm not quite as high as what our boy Nate Duncan is. He's the lead cheerleader on the Jamal Murray bandwagon, but Nate's a fantastic evaluator of talent. So if he's going to be as good as what Nate thinks he is, then he is going to be a very good player. I still think that he is. I think he's a top 4 talent out of this draft, and wouldn't feel crazy about thinking that he could be a top 2 or top 3 guy in this draft. And he's got a pretty decent fantasy game. Scoring, he can pass, he can get some rebounds, he obviously hits threes, and his defense hasn't been as much of a disaster recently as what it has been in the past. Now, whether they make him into a full-time point guard and you know, play him and Gary Harris together, and then Moutier, I don't know what happens there. But there's a lot of value in Jamal Murray. This is obviously not the best time to go and acquire him in Dynasty Leagues after he just dropped 17. But when he goes back to a 12 or 13 minute role, if that happens, then you can approach, then you can try and get him, because I think you're going to have some pretty good seasons from Jamal moving forward. Farton, Will Barton with Gaz Harris back. 26 minutes for Barton, 1, 2 and 6. This is what Will Barton does, and this is what is frustrating with Will Barton, that now that Gaz is back, yes, Manny Moutier is out, but it's going to be hard to own Farton for the foreseeable future until Harris goes down. He is inconsistent. He's nowhere near as inconsistent as what he was last season, but he is still an inconsistent player, and that might not work for you in standard leagues. For the Wolves, we've talked about Townsie, we've talked about Dunn. Shahbaz Muhammad played big minutes here, 33 minutes at the expense of Gorgui Dieng, 20 points with 5 rebounds and 2 triples. Great for, say, 16-team leagues, Muhammad, because he is playing so much better recently, but not enough to make you really consider him in 12-team as well. As I mentioned, Dieng, only the 17 minutes, 4 points with 2 steals and a block. He could have very likely have a couple of these in a row, because that seems to be what happens, but I'm not worried too much about his role. Zach LaVine is at the absolute low point of his value. 4 points in 33 minutes for Zachy, 2 rebounds, 1 assist, and 1 steal. If you can acquire him for pennies on the dollar, do it. Absolutely do it. This is a massive cold streak, and I go and read things, fantasy forums, websites, to get the overwhelming perspective of people, and people are pissed at LaVine. You know, screw this guy, he's killing me, I want to dump him. When people get that emotionally reactive about a player, dumb shit is going to happen. So you be on the other end of the dumb shit, because when dumb shit happens on one side of the trade, the other side means good stuff is going to happen. So get him, acquire him, use that those people's rage and furiousness to get LaVine cheap. Throw Lou Williams at them. Throw Damari Carroll at them after today's game. Throw Brandon Knight at them with a trade stash story. Throw Seth Curry at them. Throw these, you know, crap options, because again, the LaVine owner is pissed. They're not happy. This guy's terrible. That's the vibe that's coming. Take advantage of it. Pull their pants down, smack them on the ass, and take LaVine for nothing. Very straightforward. Well, it's not that straightforward, but that's the way that you should be approaching it anyway. All right. Let's pause the action from today's... Well, not pause. That's it. That's the action from today's games. We are done with that segment of the podcast. I'm going to take a quick break, and then we're going to be back to preview all 9 games from Monday. We're back. Let's talk perfect DFS lineups. We'll start with FanDuel. Lord Alfred Payton, 42.8, and Eric Bledsoe, 62.7. At shooting guard, DeMar DeRozan, 33.6, and out of the blue, Gaz Harris for 33.7. At small forward, Kevin Durant, 45, and Shahbaz Muhammad with 27.5. At power forward, Dwighty Powell at 27.9. He took advantage of a very, very dispirited Lakers mob, and Darrell Arthur at 26.6, and Karl Towns at 60.9 for a total of 360.7, and that cost you $59,500. If you did play DFS today, I didn't, because they were terrible slates over here in Australia. You know, 2-game slates are a nightmare, so I did not play today. How did you go? Did you win? Did you cash your double ups? Did you cash your GPPs? Let me know how you went. On DraftKings, they didn't have a whole day slate, so this is the perfect lineup for the main slate, which is the last 2 games, Phoenix, Toronto, and Denver, Minnesota. Bledsoe at 68.5, Booker at 33.5, Muhammad 29.75, Townsie's at 66, Valanciunas at 43, Chris Dunn at 39.75, Wigos at 37, and Gaz Harris at 36 for a total of 353.5, and that cost $49,100. Let's move into these games for Monday. There are nine of them on. The first one is Washington and Charlotte. The Hornets are favored by 4, and the total is 213.5 points. The injury we need to pay attention to here is Jeremy Lamb from Charlotte, who's questionable. He's not going to make that much of a difference, though, but without Lamb, Michael Kidd-Gilchrist feels a little bit solider, or more solid is probably the better way of putting that in this scenario. Let's talk point guards. We've got two good point guards here, Johnny Wall, Kemba Walker. John is at 9,700. He's averaging 50 over the last three. The matchup here is a significant positive one. I've got no issue with spending up on John Wall on this slate of games on Monday, especially if you want to move down from Russ Westbrook and you don't want to spend the $12,000 on Russ. You know, taking 97 on Johnny is absolutely a way to go. Kemba Walker, well, he gets the defense of John Wall, which is speaking of Wall, he's at 93 on DraftKings. That's a fantastic value over there. Kemba's at 79 on FanDuel and 81 on DraftKings. He's fine, but the defense of John Wall can be a concern. He only dropped 26 in the last game. He's probably not the guy that I would want to go for in this spot with this matchup, but he can clearly get to 40+, so that makes him a GPP guy. But how much over it does he actually get? Is it enough to warrant it? I'm not sure. 6,700 for Bradles Beal on FanDuel is a nice price. He's the same price on DraftKings. He's been up and down is probably a fair way of putting Brad Beal's performances lately, averaging just 27 over the last five. But there aren't many great shooting guards in this mid-price range if that's the way you're looking to assemble a lineup. Plus, it's a decent positive matchup against Charlotte as well for Beal. So I think he's fine to use on both sides. I probably prefer him a little bit more on FanDuel, but otherwise, you know, he's a good option. Nick Batum's at 7,300. He had 42 in the last game. His lowest score in his last five has been 24, which is obviously not cutting it at 7,300. But he is he's a guy that can put up those numbers comfortably. I just don't like the matchup, and the price is a little scary. On DraftKings at 7,700, it's more than a little scary. It's a lot scary. Michael Kidd-Gilchrist up to 5,400 after a pretty consistent run. He's averaging 30 points over the last five games. At 5,400, it's not a complete write-off of value. The matchup is a negative one, but I still think that you could consider Kidd-Gilchrist. I still have my doubts about him, though. I still find him to be somewhat of a risky play. If Jezza Lamb is out, I would get a little bit more confidence with Kidd-Gilchrist here. Otto Porter at 6,300. Porter's been great this year, no doubt about that. He's at 6,200 on DraftKings, but 6,300? I don't really feel it on this slate. The matchup is basically a neutral one for him, but can he get 33 points? It just feels like a little bit of a stretch for Otto at the moment, but there is use in him. He does have some value. At power forward, Jason Smith is at 3,600 on FanDuel, and he's at 3,000 on DraftKings. He's crushing it at the moment on DraftKings. He had 24 in the last game. He's averaging 20.5 over the last three, and he's getting minutes, and he's taking them away from Marchand Gortat, and he's getting all the backup center minutes. So at $3,000 in a good matchup, I've got no problem with using him on DraftKings. On FanDuel at 3,600, I'm probably not quite as in love with it. It's still a positive, but nothing you can do better, but $3,000 on DraftKings. Really, really like Jason Smith at that price. And what a time to be alive that I can say that I really, really like Jason Smith. Marvin Williams at 4,800. That is FanDuel stealing money. So no thanks. He's at 46 on DraftKings. I just have no faith in him being able to crack 25 points at all. And Frank the Tank Kaminsky, well, he's as up and down as they get. Yeah, you might look at him as a GPP player, but I don't even think his upside is necessarily all that high. Markieff Morris is crushing at the moment. He's at 6,400, but it's a fairly high price, as you're aware. 6,300 on DraftKings, it's the same story. He's averaging 34 in the last three. He dropped a 42 in the last game. No, he didn't. Sorry, he had dropped 36 in the last game. That's okay, but I think he can do better than Markieff Morris. The centers provide a decent amount of value here. Cody Zeller's at 5,000 on DraftKings, and he's on 5,000 at FanDuel. He got back in business in the last game, played 31 minutes, had 29 points. I think that getting, I think he's a good cash center, really solid guy that's going to get you 27 to 28 and feel like there's value in that spot. Marcin Gortat, I feel no confidence in him whatsoever. He's at 5,700, but his minutes have come down. His usage is invisible a lot of the time. I just have no real love for Marcin Gortat, unfortunately for Marcin. I'm sure he cares immeasurably. Let's move on to the next game now. We're going to talk about the Sacramento Kings taking on the Detroit Pistons. No spread is released at the moment because we don't know the status of Michael Beneje. No, I'm joking. We don't know the status of Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. Well, we know his status. It's questionable. So that means he's a 50-50% chance of playing. So for those of you who don't know, that probable is 75% chance of playing. Questionable is 50-50 and doubtful is 25%. That's the official designation of those tags. Questionable, probable, doubtful. So when you see them, and you say, oh, yeah, what's the chance of this guy playing? Like, if they're questionable, they're 50-50. Now, sometimes someone might land on the doubtful side of questionable or the probable side of questionable, and that boosts their odds a little bit there, or someone's listed as probable just out of routine. But that's the official definitions of what those tags mean. Sacramento at Detroit. Point guards. Yeah, the Sacramento point guards, that's a nightmare. No idea what's going to happen with them on a game-to-game basis. Darren Collison's at 4,500. Ty Lawson is at 4,300. But can you really consider using them? The answer is generally no. On DraftKings, though, Ty Lawson's at 4,000. He's averaging 20 points over the last three. He could get hot. But against Detroit, I don't really love it. And it would just be a GPP option. As for Collison, I don't really see any rationale behind really using him in any scenario. He's just been really poor and the minute split doesn't help at all. Reggie Jackson at 6,400 on FanDuel. He dropped 33 in the last game. He's averaging 31 over the last three. He did have that really cold and poor stretch. But I think that he is in an okay type of spot. Nothing spectacular for Reggie, and I'd really dislike it at 6,600 on DraftKings. Let's talk shooting guards. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, well, really hard to get behind him unless we know that he's playing. Garrett Temple, who started the last couple of games without Rudy Gay, he doesn't do anything with the points. Like, he had 22 points average over the last three in 31 minutes, and at 4,300, that's sort of right where it needs to be, I guess. But there's no upside there for Garrett Temple, so he's not a GPP player. Is he a solid cash guy? I don't even think he's that, because he can go invisible, he can see low usage, he can not hit shots, and that's relatively common for him. I just don't see it with Garrett Temple really at all. Aaron Aflalo at 3,600? No. DraftKings, though, he's at 3,000. He played 35 minutes in the last game. He scored 22 points. Now, I don't like Aaron Aflalo as a player. I don't think he's a good fantasy contributor at all. But at $3,000, you get me 22 points, then you're in a lineup. It's as simple as that. I don't know whether he will do it, but he's worth a look in a tournament, because getting 3,000, getting 22 points at $3,000 is a good way to set up the rest of your lineup. So that's the way I'd be looking at Big Az. Any other shooting guards? Reggie Bullock gets Kentavious Caldwell-Pope's minutes if KCP is out, so you could look at him as a GPP type of guy as well. He's done okay. Matty Barnes is really not taking advantage of any of Rudy Gay's absence just at this point, so I don't really see Barnesy as being a viable option here at all. Well,
pretty good.
Oops.
Did not mean that at all,
but hey, there we go. Marcus Morris has been pretty good. He's averaging 39 points over the last three games, and he's at 5,400. If Kentavious Caldwell-Pope remains out, then Morris is a guy that you can grab and you can use. I don't feel great about it, but at 5,400, he can definitely be useful. On DraftKings at 5,900, he's averaging 42 over the last three games. So I can see why you would use him. If KCP plays, though, I don't see the use in Marcus Morris. So it is very dependent on Caldwell-Pope's status. Stan Johnson only played the 16 in the last game with Johnny Lua back, so hard to see him being a GPP upside guy. Power forward John Lua is a guy that I'm interested in, 4,500. Power forwards get huge bumps against Sacramento. He is sub 5,000. He had 25 in his first game back. He could very easily get 26, 27 in this game. And I do like the scenario here, especially if they say they're going to move him to starter. And not that it normally changes much, but if they say they're putting him back as the starter, what it means is that he won't play 24 minutes, so that the minutes restriction will be gone and he'll play that 30-minute role. If he stays on the bench, he might play 30 or he might play 24. So there's a little bit of concern there, but he still exceeded his value in his last game coming off the bench. So I do really like John Lua. The matchup's fantastic. Anthony Tolliver against his former team, maybe. He's averaging 10 points the last three games, and that's without Rudy Gay. So can you look at him as a GPP guy? Absolutely. He's getting the minutes. He just needs a day where the shots fall. But you can't trust that for cash games at all. Toby Harris at 6,100. I like Toby as a cash game play. I don't think there's much upside, but I think that he's solidly going to get you that 5X type of value. So have a look at Toby Harris there. At center, Andre Drummond, 7,700. 7,100 on DraftKings. He's always a risky play, and now he takes on DeMarcus Cousins. He's got a decent record against Cousins, and the 7,100 for him on DraftKings is very, very appealing. So I would be okay using him as a GPP on DraftKings. I would even maybe lean towards cash on DraftKings. Probably not, but I would consider it. On FanDuel, he is strictly a GPP guy and not quite as high upside as what he is over on DraftKings. Costa Koufos, he's at $3,000. So this is a couple of $3,000 players on DraftKings today, or Tuesday, or Monday, whatever. Monday? Yeah, Monday. A couple of $3,000 players that are worth having a look at. Koufos is playing extra minutes with Gay out. He got 20 points in 25 minutes in the last one, averaging 17 over the last three in 24 minutes. He's got tournament upside. He can get a double-double. He can grab some points and some boards and block some shots. That can be useful at that minimum salary. 36 on FanDuel, not quite as exciting. As for Boogie, 10,900. We know he's going to be taking a lot of shots. He's going to have the ball in his hands a lot. Yeah, no issue with Boogie at all. 10.5 on DraftKings, 10.9 on FanDuel. Load up your Boogie and get ready to go. Let's move on to the next game. San Antonio Spurs and the Brooklyn Nets. We need to check the status of Manu Ginobili, who left last game with a back problem. I would be shocked if Manu plays in this one because it is the first game of a back-to-back and he's dealing with a back injury. So it's going to be really tough to see Manu playing. On the surface, it's a brilliant matchup for the Spurs. They're favored by 12. It's just a brilliant game playing against Brooklyn for fantasy stats. But it's the Spurs. They could be up by 30 in the third quarter and no one plays any minutes. So that is the risk with studs like Kawhi and lesser studs like LaMarcus Aldridge. Let's talk. Matone Parker is out of this one as well. Let's talk point guards. Pat Mills is at 3,600. He played 31 minutes in the last game, put up 24 points. He's absolutely worth a look. You can at 3,600 for Patty Mills, I think you should feel pretty okay about using him. Over on DraftKings, Mills is at 4,000, so a little bit elevated. It's a $900 price rise over there, but I still think that you can use him over there. Again, the matchup's brilliant, and he'll be getting some good minutes. The other point guards, Spencer Dinwiddie, Isaiah Whitehead, I can't really see any of those being useful players. Shooting guards, DeJounte Murray, listed as a shooting guard on FanDuel. He's at 3,800. He's averaging 22 points in the last three games. He dropped 23 in the last game in a game where he played just 22 minutes for Mills' 31. So with the great matchup here, love DeJounte Murray at 3,800. On DraftKings, he's at 4,100. So that takes a little bit of the shine off it. But still, I think that he can be used. There is obviously a risk with using DeJounte Murray in that how exactly are they going to use him? How many minutes is he going to get? But Parker's out. He's going to start, and he's going to play 22, 23 minutes. No problem with that whatsoever. But there is just a little bit of risk for him in cash games. All right, now just give me one sec for you guys watching this video. I just have a slight emergency, nothing to worry about, but I just need to pause the show for a second. I'll be back in approximately 30 seconds. All right, guys, we're back. Sorry about that that little delay. It got everything sorted that needed to be sorted. So I told you it was just going to be a little small interruption. Dan Green at shooting guard, 3,500 on FanDuel. Nothing too... Look, he's a GPP guy, but how often is he actually hitting GPP value? The answer is not really at all, so I don't really see much to like there with Dan Green. Now, if Manu happens to be out, John Simmons is going to be the guy that really jumps into consideration. Simmons only played 8 minutes in the last game and had 3 points, but he's a minimum salary player on FanDuel and on DraftKings, and he can easily drop 24, 25, which at those minimum salaries can easily work out in his favor. So John Simmons is the guy to look for if Manu happens to be out. Sean Kilpatrick had a good game in the last one, 27 points, is at 4,100. If he happens to start again, I would be okay in a GPP with him, but he has been poor for like 3, 4, 5 weeks maybe and had one good game, so I wouldn't be reading too much into it and thinking, you know, beginning of the season, Sean Kilpatrick is back. Would not be locking him into any cash game lineups. At small forward, Rondae Hollis-Jefferson at 4,500. I just have no ability to trust him at that salary. While Kawhi Leonard is at 9,800 now on FanDuel. Yes, the matchup is brilliant. He's at 9,400 on DraftKings. Yes, the matchup is brilliant. But the minutes is the worry here. Like, how much do the Spurs spank the Nets by? And how much does Kawhi play? Because he played 46 minutes the last game. He's averaging 40 minutes the last three games. That's very un-pop. It's very unlikely that he plays that many minutes here. And you need him to get around 50 points. He's been playing fantastically, but I just fear that this is not the time to use Kawhi Leonard in most cases, at that elevated salary anyway. Bojan Bogdanovic is at 4,400. He's at 44 on DraftKings as well. He's always just a GPP type of a play. While Caris LeVert is a little bit of a tough guy to use. Under 4,000, no problem. Over 4,000, no thanks. Power forward Dave Lee at 5,100. He dropped 33 in the last game. He's playing very well. It looks like Popovich is going with Lee over Dedmon. I don't think anything that's going to happen in this game will make him change his mind. I don't think the Nets are going to start tearing them apart defensively, which would be the only reason that Dedmon would get in over Lee. So Lee at 5,100, which is obviously a significant price bump, and he's at 55 on DraftKings. You know, I like him on FanDuel. 55 on DraftKings is probably just a little bit much. Yeah, you need 30 points out of him almost to break even, and I don't really feel confident in saying David Lee's getting me 30 points every night to break even. I just don't feel good about that. 51 on FanDuel, though, is totally fine. Trev Booker at 5,300. No, just not that sort of guy at the moment. While LaMarcus Aldridge is priced at 7,600. He's at 6,900 on DraftKings.
Giggity!
He's playing better, no doubt about that. LaMarcus Aldridge is playing a little bit better at the moment, averaging 36 across the last three, but I don't really feel that this is going to be a great spot for him because, like Kawhi, he's playing a lot of minutes, and this might be a chance for him to not play a lot of minutes, again, given it's the first game of a back-to-back for the Spurs. At center, Brook Lopez at 7,600. Not really. 6,500 on DraftKings? Yeah, fine. He's averaging 42.5 on the last three games, Brookie. 39 in his last five. His lowest score is 34 points in the last five games on DraftKings. 6,500, you get me 34 points as your worst score? Then what's the problem? No issue. Yeah, the Spurs quite good defensively. They do restrict big men, but I feel pretty good that he's going to be able to make up $6,500 worth of value over there. The 76 on FanDuel is maybe a little bit of a stretch. Dwayne Dedmon, 3,700, probably tough to use him considering that Pop played him just 10 minutes in the last game, which is not enough to get us our value that we need. All right, let's move on to the next game now. The Los Angeles Clippers and the Atlanta Hawks. Mike Muscala has been ruled out for the Hawks. Obviously, we know that the Clippers are without Chris Paul. Blake Griffin has been upgraded to doubtful. So as I touched on earlier, doubtful means a 25% chance of playing. Let's assume that he is not playing, but that means that his return is going to come pretty swiftly. In the next couple of games, we're probably going to see Blake back. Now, I don't know what Doc is going to do. The last game, he changed the starting lineup. They got killed. He wasn't happy about it. And we might see them go back to the Luke Marmute situation at the four with Paul Millsap playing the four in Atlanta. Maybe he doesn't want to put Mo Spates on Paul Millsap, which would be completely justifiable. And that would mean that we're going to get more Ray Felton and maybe not more Austin Rivers because he played some pretty big minutes in the last game. Let's talk point guards now. Austin is at 5,400. I feel pretty good that Austin Rivers is getting 50. Oh, 50, shit. I wish I was feeling good he'd get 50 points. I feel good that he's getting 25 points at that 5,400 price tag, and that gives me enough reason to consider him a guy that, you know, you should feel pretty comfortable about putting into both cash and tournament lineups. At 5,900 on DraftKings, I'm not quite as on board with that. That feels just a little bit high, so I'll probably give him a pass over there. Ray Felton is at 4,900, and even off the bench, he played 30 minutes in the last game and dropped 22 points. This is a very, very positive matchup. We know that the Hawks and point guards, it generally works in the opposition point guard's favor, so I'm okay with 4,900 on Ray Felton. On DraftKings, I'm not as okay with 5,600. That's just a little bit high. And along with Austin Rivers, neither of those guys are must-play guys on DraftKings. But they are absolutely fine to consider over on FanDuel. Just the differences between the pricings at the sites. Dennis Schroeder is at 6,500. He had 35 in the last game. And yes, the Clippers are a negative matchup for point guards. But a lot of that data is built on when Chris Paul is around. And Chris Paul is not around, as you're well aware. So can we get 33 out of Dennis Schroeder? Yeah. Do I expect it? No. I think that he is a GPP guy only. And even then, not necessarily a great one. Shooting guards, Jamal Crawford, he's been dreadful. But he did have 21 points in the last game. He's at 3,900. I think there's tournament upside in Jamal Crawford. But that is literally it. At 44 on DraftKings, that's a joke. I want nothing to do with that. Over on DraftKings, that price is way too expensive. Jamal Crawford's at 4... Not sure. I just did Jamal. JJ Redick is at 4,700. He had 24 on the last game. He's been consistent, but consistently poor. And maybe not poor. Consistently average is maybe the best way of putting what JJ Redick has been doing. Yeah, he's got some upside. I'll probably just use him as a GPP only type of guy, and as Tim Hardaway, he's at 4,700 as well, dropped 25 in the last game, but there is no way I feel comfortable with using Timmy in any cash game situation. Tarbo's at 3,600, I don't want that, and Kent Bazemore at 4,300. Kent had a good game in the last one. It was 21 points. I don't really think that you should be looking at Kent Bazemore in really any scenario. At power forward, Mo Spates at 4,500 on FanDuel. He's at 43 on DraftKings. Even if he goes back to a bench role, I think that at 4,300, he can achieve that sort of a value. So I'm okay with using Mo Spates, assuming Blake Griffin doesn't play, of course. And at 45 on FanDuel, he's all right, but not quite the same value as he is over on DraftKings. Whereas Paul Millsap at 8,100. I don't know if there's much GPP upside in Millsap, but I feel pretty good about him getting me 40 points and returning value at 78 on DraftKings. The same story. He's averaging 38 points across the last three games on DraftKings, and I think he can have a fairly decent sort of go at it against the Clippers here. With Mike Muscala out, Chris Humphries gets himself some extra minutes. He's averaging 20 across the last three. He's at sub 4,000, 3,800, and 3,400 over on DraftKings. He's a low-owned player that you can definitely have a look at. And he's a guy that I reckon is going to be your low-owned GPP fluke-type play. I think that he should be included. If you're running multiple lineups, I think you want one with Humphries in there, just because I do get this feeling that we're going to get a 26 or 27-point weird Chris Humphries night come out of this one. Again, that's total gut-feel scenario there. At center, DeAndre Jordan, Dwight Howard. DeAndre's at 8,400. I don't feel comfortable with that whatsoever, especially against Dwight. As for Dwight at 6,900, yeah, I'm okay with Dwight at 6,900. I think that's a good price. DraftKings at 7,000, not quite behind that, but I would take Dwight over DeAndre Jordan on both sides. Now, Jordan is down to 7,900 over on DraftKings, but I'm still not totally feeling that without Chris and without Blake Griffin around. Let's move on to the next game up. We're talking about Golden State. They're taking on the Miami Heat. Sean Kilpatrick should be back after resting Sunday's game. And for Miami, we want to check the status of Tyler Johnson, who missed the last game with a shoulder issue. The Warriors are favored by 11. The total is 216. So this is the Warriors' second half of the Miami, or the Florida back-to-back, sorry. They beat the Magic today in a comfortable victory. Does anyone sit out? I think if anyone sits out, it's going to be Andre Iguodala. I don't think any of the big four guys are going to sit. if Tyler Johnson happens to miss for the Heat, that boosts Deion Waiters' value. It boosts Wayne Ellington into GPP consideration as well. Let's talk point guards. Goran Dragic, 7,100. In a matchup against Steph, I think that Goran at 7,100 is absolutely fine to use. I don't think that it's a tough matchup for him. It's a decently high price. I think he can achieve it. At 7,200 on DraftKings, maybe that's pushing the friendship just a little bit. He is averaging 41 across the last three there, so it's not terrible. It's not a crazy ask to think that he's going to get there. But it's not a bad situation. As for Steph, yeah, good game from Steph today, obviously. Yeah, drained, yeah, seven triples. He's at $9,000. I don't want to use Steph Curry at $9,000 when it's a nine-game slate and I can do better. At 8,700 on DraftKings, yeah, he's got a good record against Miami. Very good. I just don't see it happening. Blowout risk, could go to Durant, could go to Clay, could get sat. Heat provides slower paced games with good defense. I just don't see the need in playing Steph in this sort of a matchup scenario. Other shooting guards around, there's no one to really bother us too much here. Tyler Johnson, he's at 6,100. That remains way too high. At shooting guard, Clay Thompson's at 6,200. GPP only, but even then, I'm not really excited. Well, Deion Waiters is up to 5,500. That is high. He had 44 points on DraftKings in the last game at 5,700, and that obviously repays it, but do I have faith in Deion Waiters? The answer should always be no, if that's the question. But in a GPP, if Tyler Johnson happens to be out, then Deion is someone that you can have a look at as a guy that absorbs some of his shots, gets some of his ball handling, and takes control of the ball more and passes it and gets some assists, and that can work out. But that's really, to me, only if Tyler Johnson happens to be out of this game. Wayne Ellington had 25 in the last game at 3,700, GPP guy only if Tyler Johnson happens to be out. Small forwards, Kev Durant, 10,600. I think you lock Durant in for high 40s, 50 points pretty much every single game. He's at 10,000 exact on DraftKings. Yeah, no problem with using Durant in both formats here. While Scooter Magruder is obviously a no-go. At power forward, James Johnson has been limiting us. He is far from been making us proud. He's been far from our martyr. He's been far from our only son. Maybe he can do it today. Come on, Jimmy. The shot hasn't been there, but the other numbers have. He's at 5,900. The problem is this is a shitful matchup for him against the Warriors. He's at 6,000 on DraftKings. Somehow his price has jumped $200. I would only consider Jimmy in a GPP. That's really about it for James. Draymond at 8,200. Don't like the matchup against Miami. He hasn't been producing the value with that sort of a salary. Just a little bit too high for Draymond. I think that you always can throw him in a GPP, but no interest in him in any cash game scenario. Hassan Whiteside. I don't want to use Hassan Whiteside at 8,500 against the Warriors. That is as simple as it gets. 4,200 for Zaza. Yeah, you know what? Zaza, if you're looking for a cheap center to fill out a lineup, 3,800 on DraftKings. Zaza's averaging 23 points in the last five on DraftKings. At 3,800, you will take that every day of the week. Put him in and see how you feel at the rest of your lineup, but that is absolutely usable. And for as unsexy as it is, I don't care how unsexy it is, if he's getting 23 points at 3,800, that's fine. Then let me put my other big names in. That can definitely work. I'm not saying he's a must guy or he's a core guy to start a lineup or anything like that. But it's a route that you should be considering when you're building lineups. All right, let's move on to the next game. We've got the Cleveland Cavaliers taking on the New Orleans Pelicans. The Cavs are favored by 6 on the road, and the total here is 216. Anthony Davis should be back. He is listed as probable with a thigh contusion, so he'll probably take 4 or 5 trips to the locker room during this game. Let's talk point guards here. Not a lot to love, to be honest, in this game in general. Yes, there's some big-priced and high-priced studs. Probably a little bit more impressive with those guys over on DraftKings. But we'll start with point guard on FanDuel, and Drew Holiday's at 6,400. Drew has put up some decent games. I don't want to spend 6,400 on Drew in any cash game scenario just at this point. Yeah, he can drop 40, and it is Kyrie Irving defense that he's up against, so that works out perfectly in that scenario. But there's no way of being able to trust Drew at this point. He's at 71 on DraftKings, so that's a total forget about it in any sort of situation, I believe. As for Kyrie at 8,100, he dropped 48 in the last game in 41 minutes against the Spurs. Huge game from him. Do I expect 40 out of Kyrie here? No, because if I did, then I'd lock him in cash. The matchup is a bit of a positive for him. Drew's a good defender, but you know, Pelicans have still allowed point guards to put up some decent numbers. I don't feel good about Kyrie in anything outside of a GPP here. Shooting guards, Tyreek Evans, 5,600. I don't even know why I'm bringing up Tyreek Evans, because that's just too highly priced. And at 5,900 on DraftKings, you can forget that. Iman Shumpert is the guy we need to pay some attention to. He's at 4,000 bucks and he is playing very well. More minutes, more production, more shots, more steals, more threes is what's coming from him. He's averaging 25.5 over the last three, which at 4,000 bucks is absolutely beautiful. On DraftKings, he's at 4,000 as well. No problem with using him on Shumpert in a very similar vein to, as I mentioned, Zaza Pachulia. You need a cheap-ass guy to put in? Put Iman in. Get your 24, 25 points at 4,000. Be thankful, get your multiplier, and get the other guys in who are going to hopefully take you to glory and get the big scores. But locking in a guy that feels relatively safe for, you know, 5, 6X, it's really hard to you know, knock that. And that's, I think, where Shumpert is currently sitting. Langston Galloway is an upside GPP guy. He can go off. He can do nothing. His last five games, he's at a four-pointer and a 26-pointer. That's sort of, you know, where he resides. Kyle Korver and Bud Hield, they're both sub 4,000. Yes, they both can get hot and hit some threes, but I wouldn't be banking on it too much. At small forward, LeBronald. Big price difference here from LeBron. 10,600 on FanDuel, 99 on DraftKings. Love it on DraftKings. 9,900 against the Pelicans. No problem with using LeBron. It's only a 6-point spread. We're not expecting big blowout here. Love it. 10,600 is creating a little bit more of an issue over on FanDuel, but if you don't want to take the 10,000 bucks that they're offering up for Kawhi, if you don't want to take the 10,600 they're offering for Durant, LeBron is obviously an option there. But he's averaging just 41 the last five games. So 10,600 does not seem like a very good investment at all. That's not the direction that I would be going, nor would I be taking Solomon Hill or Dante Cunningham. Let's talk power forwards. Kevin Love is at 7,500. Been a little bit underwhelming the last few games, averaging under 25 points in his last five. He's at 76 on DraftKings. Again, averaging 27 over the last five. These are poor numbers. But I think this is an opportunity for Love to bounce back. I'm expecting a pretty big performance out of him here. Our projections love him as well. So I'm expecting a day from Love where he's going to have value and potentially even as a cash game play also. Tony Davis has dropped by 700 bucks on FanDuel, down to 11,200 now. Very tough at the moment given his injury to consider him a cash option, but as a GPP guy, I think a lot of people will be off Davis, and that makes him an option that could go for 70 with limited ownership. So absolutely, he's a GPP guy. Real tough to consider him a cash guy just at this point, though. At center, we're talking Tristan Thompson only, and I don't want to talk Tristan Thompson, really. He's at 4,900, and I just don't really see the upside in doing that. If you want to play Omer Asik, you might as well just post your money to me. The next game, Houston and the Bucks. The Rockets are favored by 4.5. These two teams met last week and the Rockets spanked them. The total here is the highest of the day, 223. Ryan Anderson is likely back after missing the last couple of games with the flu. So any value that Sammy Decker had is likely going to be smacked on the head pretty quickly here. Now, Jabari Parker apparently didn't start the last game because he talked to the media. Cool. He is likely going to be back, so Thon Maker's starting reign is likely over after one game. But what they do with Dellavedova and Brogdon remains to be seen. What they do with Henson and Munro remains to be seen. It's Jason Kidd, so probably the opposite of common sense is what's going to come into play, and that makes it a tough scenario to take a look at. Let's talk point guards first, though. Dally had 27 points in that last game. He's at 3,700. The Pat Beverly matchup is a pain, but if we hear that Dally is starting, Does that mean that he's getting 36 minutes? A lot of the time it doesn't, because at the start of the season, before Brogdon was doing anything, Dellavedova was starting and playing 27 minutes. So how reliable should it be? Well, it's not at all. Now, the good thing that Kidd did, and I'll always give credit where it's due, is he played Dellavedova and Brogdon together. And that's something I can totally get behind, because Tony Snell is terrible. And both Brogdon and Dellavedova are better than him. So if that's a way to give both these guys 30 minutes, then I'm all for it. Dally at 3,700 is a GPP guy. He is, but you can't really look at him as a cash guy. On DraftKings at 3,500, fine. But it is hard to look at him as a guy you can trust. As for Brogo at 5,200, yeah, that's not really working for me if they're going to run him off the bench. Well, he shot like 1 of 10 in the last game. I don't think that'll happen again. But do I also trust that Jason Kidd gives him 30 off the bench? No, I'm very far from trusting that. And at that extra salary and 52 on DraftKings, I'm just not thinking that that's going to be the way to go for Brogo. As for Pat Beverley, well, that's the other thing. They've got to take on Pat Beverley. Beverley's at 5,600 in this game. Bucks point guards, or going up against the Bucks as a point guard, hasn't been an easy task for a lot of people this season. Beverley's been a little bit up and down of late. I don't think that he's a great option at the prices of 5,600 and 52 FanDuel and DraftKings respectively. I'm not sure that he's a great option in this matchup. Shooting guards, Giannis, 10,800. Feel totally fine about using him. And on the other side of things, Jimmy Harden is at 11,900. He's dropping 54.5 over the last five games on FanDuel. You feel pretty good about using both Jim and Yanni. On DraftKings, you've got Jimmy up at 12,100. That's obviously a pretty steep price, but he's averaging 61 points in the last five games over on DraftKings. So you get some of those cheaper players in. That enables you to put Jim in there, get your 55 to 60, and get your lineup cracking in that way. Small forward Trevor Ariza has been piss poor lately. At 5,200, a guy averaging just under 18 points in the last three is not getting it done. But you can absolutely, in a great matchup, really, really good matchup, you can absolutely have a look at Trev and go with him. I think he's a very good GPP play. And at 5,300 on DraftKings, everything I said is the same. A really, really great option for using Trev. But trust-wise, it's not high. Beasley, after a real strong run of games, has been kitted. So, yeah, tough to rely on him. While Sammy Decker dropped 39 in the last game, he's up to 4,300. With Anderson back, I just don't see Decker getting enough minutes to be relevant enough to use in DFS. It's going to be tough to consider him if Rhino is back, as we expect. Mirza Teletovic, DNP CD last game. Mirza is averaging 2.7 points over the last three games he's actually played, so just wanted to bring up how disgustingly bad he has been used this season. As for Ryan Anderson at 4,600, that's a very cheap price for Ryan Anderson, probably because he's averaging 10 points in the last three games. Yes, one of those was illness-related, but still, he hasn't been good. At 4,600, I totally think that you can use that as a GPP, but Ryan Anderson should always only be used as a GPP option. That's basically, should be tattooed on his head or something. I'm pretty sure he wouldn't want that, but you should tattoo it on his name whenever you see it mentioned. Ryan Anderson, GPPs only. Jabari Snitch Parker. I use that snitch term very loosely. I don't really care that he spoke to the media, but apparently the players did. Good for them. Regardless, he's going to be back starting 7,400. Decent matchup, good pace. No problem with using Jabari Parker here. I think it's a good play. 6,900 for him on DraftKings. Yeah, still no worries. He should be able to exceed 35 points and get that value back without too much of a hassle. The table, Montrezl Harrell. Well, him, Nene, and Clint Capela all played 16 minutes in the last game, so that makes using any of them an absolute nightmare. Now, the Bucks front court, we know that big numbers come against them from power forwards and centers. We know that. But who's it going to be? Is it going to be Clint? Is it going to be Montrez? Is it going to be Nene? Probably not. So I would consider I'd consider Montrezl Harrell as a GPP guy at 4,800. He can get to 30, no problem. In fact, he's averaging 36 points against the Bucks. Well, he only played one game, but he had a huge one against them, so he can do that. But that's GPP only. Let's swing straight into Clint Capela, who's at 4,800. The same story. He can have a 35, 36 point game. But knowing how the minutes are going to shake out, impossible. GPPs only. you wouldn't want to play Capella and Harrell in the same lineup, but you would have GPP lineups with one of them in, and you know, then switch it out for the other guy. And then you have, you could even have the same lineup, because at the moment we're sort of splitting the difference with the minutes here. You have some lineups without either of them, some with one of them, and some with the other one, and see how that pans out. But if one of them gets 27 minutes, then they're going to beat their value. But we don't know who it'll be, and we don't know if any of them will do it, or if they'll just split the minutes down the middle, which is the frustrating thing. Greg Monroe, three straight games, under 20 minutes a game. He's at 5,200. That's a hard pass. While Johnny Henson at 3,600. He had 22 in the last game. The minutes have been up. It hasn't been awesome, but at 3,600, if I can get 20 points, I'm okay with that. And at 35 on DraftKings, the same story. I think that he does have some GPP value there, but it's Jason Kidd, so who knows exactly how it's all going to pan out in the end. The answer is not even Jason Kidd. The next game up, we're going to talk about the New York Knickerbockers and the Indiana Pacers. The Pacers are favored by 5.5, and the total here is 219. Paul George was ejected in the last game. I imagine he plays. Lance Thomas may be back. We've got him listed as doubtful, and same as Rod Stuckey. I would be stunned if those guys played in this game. Let's talk point guards. Jeff Teague's at 7,500.
My name is Jeff.
Really strong run from Teague at the moment. He's averaging 37 across the last three. I don't think this matchup should be anything for him to fear, and he should be absolutely a guy that you can consider at that sort of a price tag and use him. On DraftKings, 7,700, same story. You should be looking at 40 points from Jeff, and that would be good value. Derrick Rose at 6,700 has been putting up great numbers. It is a very good matchup for Rose. I actually do not hate using him. He's averaging 40 points over the last three and 35 over the last five. No concerns really about using, some concerns, limited concerns. I think Derrick Rose is a pretty decent play. He's at 6,400 on DraftKings. The same story. The matchup does not frighten me with him really at all. Ronnie Baker, back to the bench and back to being a complete afterthought in your minds. Shooting guards, Courtney Lee, he's back starting. He had 24 points in the last game in 37 minutes, and he is a sub 4,000 guy. Can he get 24 points again? Yeah, maybe you're pushing the friendship a little bit, but 3,400 on DraftKings? I've got no issue with using Courtney Lee. He falls into that Zaza Pachulia basket. Sub 4,000, get me 20 plus, and then we'll talk and be pretty happy with that result. And I think that Lee can be that guy. So, yeah, consider him. Monte Ellis had a big one in the last game. He's at 3,600. You know what? Don't like Monte Ellis. Think he's a bad player, but I don't hate using him in a GPP. Little dog Glenn Robinson III's been struggling. Rod Stuckey, CJ Miles. You know, Stuckey's not playing. Miles has struggled as well. If Ellis comes in here and plays big minutes again, then at 3,600, he could exceed value. I don't think it's a high probability, but he definitely should be in a GPP player pool, I believe, in a matchup against the Knicks, which is not going to be all that tough of one. Small forwards. Paul George down to 7,000 on FanDuel. Yes, Paul George is not providing great numbers. He's at 75 on DraftKings, so that's pretty much a write-off. Somehow his salary's jumped by $500 over there. 7,000 on FanDuel. Yeah, you know what? He hasn't been hitting value. He's averaging 30 points in the last five. His highest score is just 35. But I feel pretty good about $7,000 for Paul George. I feel pretty good. I'd even stretch it to cash. And I feel really good about him in tournaments. As for Melo, 8,100. I feel pretty good that Melo is getting me 40 points here. There aren't many in that high price range. You either go Melo or you take it $2,000 higher and take Kawhi, or you go an extra $1,000 or $600 and take Durant or LeBron. So if you're trying to cut a bit of money there, you know, getting 40 out of Carmelo feels like it's a decent gamble. He's at 8,000 on DraftKings as well. I've got no problem using Carmelo Anthony in this scenario. Mindaugas Kuzminskas goes back to being a guy that you don't want to use. At power forward, Kristaps Porzingis.
Porzingis.
He is at $7,000. Has not provided that value recently. This matchup is great. He's played well against Indiana in the past. $7,000 is a decent chunk, but I think that Porzingis is a very, very good GPP play here, and this should be a scenario for him to get that value back and potentially drop a 40 spot on their head. Thad Young, caning it at the moment. He's at 5,700. Absolutely love using Thad Young. 55 on DraftKings. He's getting steals in bushels, and when he doesn't get steals, he scores, he gets rebounds. Love the matchup. Love Thad Young here. Really think it's a solid option. Centers, Miles Turner. Fantastic stuff from Turner here. 6,300. He's been a bit quiet, granted, But this is the one. This is the one against the Knicks that I think we should be looking at Miles. He's at 66 on DraftKings as well. No concerns with getting him in there and getting, you know, potentially 40 points out of Miles Turner. I do really like this one. Joakim Noah, Kylo Quinn, Billy Hernan Gomez. If you can predict any how any of that shit's going to go down, good luck to you. I can't, so then I won't be using any of those guys because Jeff Hornacek works on the new principle of reverse logic. Let's go to the last game of the night, the Oklahoma City Thunder and the Utah Jazz. Steve Adams is listed as questionable with a concussion. If he is out, I imagine they go to Jeremy Grant, but against the Jazz, it could be ugly. Maybe we get some more Joffrey Lavernier and some extra Enes Kanter, although Enes Kanter and the Jazz, that's going to be an interesting scenario. At least Trevor Booker's not there to smack him upside the head. Point guard, 12,000, Russ Westbrook. The matchup is not ideal. Russ is still ideal, but you know, 12,000 is a fair chunk. If you don't want to spend it, I can totally understand it. I don't believe he is a 100% must-play guy. In cash, you probably do want to go Russ, especially on DraftKings, where he's at 11,500. That's really hard to go past in cash games. But we know that Jazz games are a slower pace. The Jazz are a good team, and they do provide good defense. So it could be an issue for Russ in this game. So just be aware of that. Georgie Hill at 6,100 crushed it against the Pacers last game. A positive matchup for him again. Can he get to 30? I'm a little bit skeptical of that. And at 6,600 on DraftKings, I want nothing to do with it. But at 6,100 on FanDuel, I do think there's value in George Hill at that price tag. Campaign's got 20 plus minutes the last couple of games. That's obviously very useful. But will I use him? No. Shooting guard, Victor Oladipo's at 5,700. He had 35 points in the last game. The matchup here is what scares me off from him. He's been playing well, but this matchup is not an ideal one, so that's a no-go there for me. While Alec Burks had a little breakthrough, had 20 points in 19 minutes the last game. He's at 3,600. I don't really even see him being a great GPP option here. To be honest, at small forward, Joe Ingles at 3,900. Really like that. I feel really confident of Joe getting 20 points. He's averaging 25 over the last three. He's priced at 48 on DraftKings, so that's pretty much a no-go at 4,800. 3,900 on FanDuel. Love it. That's load up Joe Ingles. Gordie Haywood at 74. I've got no issue with using Haywood. You should be getting 35, 36 out of him and returning good value. And he's at 7,000 on DraftKings. Yeah, I think he's just a solid, really good cash sort of a play at that price tag. Joey Johnson and Andre Robertson, I don't think there's any use in those guys. At power forward, Derek Favors at 4,500. It's really tough to know what to expect from Favors. He's a GPP only sort of a player, but no way you can trust him in cash until these minutes come back up. While Enes Kanter at 6,400, he is getting good numbers, but in a shit matchup against Rudy Gobert, I do not want to trust Enes Kanter in this scenario. I just can't see it being a viable scenario. If Adams plays at 5,500 after missing time against Gobert, it's far from a good option whatsoever. As for Gobert, $8,100. He's been putting up numbers that have been pretty close to that majority of the time. Didn't in the last game. I love him on DraftKings at 7,300. That 8,100 on FanDuel, though, is probably just a step too far for my liking. All right, let's move now on to the picks of the day, starting with FanDuel. Pat Mills at 3,600. You could always go him or DeJounte Murray, and Murray is a shooting guard, which we'll touch on in a sec. Austin Rivers at 54, and Johnny Walls at 9,700. Shooting guard DeJounte is at 38, Brad Beal's at 67, and Yanni, 10,800. Lots of options there. Jim Harden, another one as well. At small forward, Joe Ingles, 39, Paulie George is at 7, and Mello at 8,100. Again, LeBron, Durant, Kevin Durant, yeah, that's the guy. Kawhi Leonard's the other guy I was trying to think of. At power forward, Johnny Lua, 45, Dave Lee, 51, Paulie Millsap, 81, some good value with those players. And at center, Johnny Henson's at 36, that's a GPP-only type of play. Miles Turner at 63, and Boogie is at 10,900. On DraftKings, Mills at 4,000, Jeff Teague at 77, and Westbrook at 11,500. At shooting guard, Matt Dellavedova, 3,500. Obviously just a punt, because I just went through all that sort of stuff before. Eric Gordon, 56, and Jimmy Harden, 12,100. At small forward, Aaron Aflalo's at 3,000. Trevor Ariza's at 53, and LeBron's at 99. At power forward, Mo Spates, 43. Kevin Love, 76, and Boogie is at 10,500. and its center, Costa Kufos, 3,000. Drummond at 71 as a GPP guy, and Anthony Davis, 10,800. Let's look at the Aussie sites now. Moneyball, DeJounte Murray, 35, Austin Rivers, 51, and Kyrie, 8,100. Shooting guard, Jamal Crawford as a GPP at 35, Bradles Beal, 68, and Jimmy Harden, 12,500. At small forward, Joe Ingles, 39, Paul George, 72, and LeBron at 10,300. And the power forwards, Dave Lee, 41, Porzingis at 65, that's a great price for Porzingis, and Millsap at 83. And at center, Clint Capella is a GPP at 48, Miles Turner, 68, and DeMarcus Cousins, 11,300. On draft stars, Ray Felton, 65, Jeffy Teague, 13,800, and Johnny Wall, 17,150. Shooting guard, Joe Ingles, 54, Pat Bev's, 96, and Kawhi is at 16. Small forward, Austin Rivers, 75, Marcus Morris, 8,850 if KCP is out, and LeBronald at 10,700. Power forward, Dave Lee, 6,250, James Johnson, 9,450, and Boogies at 17,250. And the centers, Mo Spates, 72, Cody Zeller, 97, and Anthony Davis, 19,100. We are done for today's show, guys. Don't forget to check out our sponsor for today, LordTimepieces.com. Head across there and use the promo code LOFANTASY and get yourself 10% off a brand new watch with free shipping worldwide. Get yourself a classy watch at a discount price. Follow me on Twitter at RedRock_Beeble and head across to Patreon.com/RedRock_Beeble if you want to support the show. We are done here, guys. Thank you so much for listening, everyone. See ya. DeMarcus Cousins.